Good evening. This is Daniel Meyer, pastor of First Baptist Church here in River Falls. We're glad that you've decided to tune in. We're thankful for those that are here this evening as we gather together to serve and worship the Lord. We're so excited what God is going to do. Just give you a brief testimony. As you know, this afternoon was on the local FM radio station, and I got a lot of feedback already from many people who've tuned in, listened on the radio, and they were really blessed. And so all we can do is pray and see what the Lord will do with that. We're hoping that the Lord will do tremendous things with that broadcast. The idea was that we'd be able to reach, maybe 90,000 souls and get a chance to hear the gospel message. What a blessing it is to serve the Lord. Amen. Even in trying times, we need to spend our efforts serving the Lord and preaching the gospel. This morning we had a wonderful service, and this evening we'll have a time of prayer and singing. And I don't have any new prayer requests other than, obviously, we should continue to pray for our nation. It's so important that we pray for not only our nation, but our first responders, our medical professionals, our elderly, the sick. We need to keep our churches and our pastors all across this country, all across the world in prayer. As you probably know, and maybe you've read on social media, none of the pastors that I know have ever pastored a church during a pandemic. From a pastor's perspective, a lot of this is uncharted territory. Right? We're very concerned for our congregation. We're very concerned for the souls that live next to us that aren't saved. And so you need to keep the pastors in America and in this world in prayer. Keep your missionaries in prayer and your evangelists in prayer. Obviously, the elderly that are isolated and kept away from everybody else, need to keep them in prayer as well. Our families, keep our families in prayer. It's a time where the Lord has stripped away everything. And I believe that He's done so that we have the opportunity to seek Him. And He's testing each of us to see if we'll actually take this opportunity to get back to basics, as it says there in the book of Jeremiah. Go back to the old paths. Go back to the old ways. The old ways work. The old paths work. The King James Bible is still the Bible to have. It's still the Word of God. What this world needs is it needs the Word of God. It needs people that believe in God, believe the Word of God, that trust in God. And so as we open our services this evening, let's go to the Lord in prayer and ask Him to heal our nation. Ask Him to bless our efforts. Ask Him to keep our people safe. Ask Him to help us to see souls saved during this trying time. Let's go to the Lord. Heavenly Father, we are dependent upon You for all things. Lord, we know that You're there. We know that You're listening. We know that we have the ability to boldly come before the throne of grace, according to the book of Hebrews. And Lord, we come tonight seeking You, seeking Your face. Lord, that You might hear our prayers. Lord, we think of our nation in the midst of this pandemic, this viral outbreak. We think of all those that are sick, all those that have the virus, all those that are in need of treatment. And Lord, we pray You'd have Your hand upon them and help them and encourage and keep them safe and heal them. We think of the first responders and the medical staff that are caring for the sick all across this nation. We ask You to keep them safe and help them to continue to endeavor to stay on the front line. We ask You to keep them healthy. We pray that they wouldn't be infected. We pray that those that are working for a vaccine and for a cure would find that vaccine and cure in rapid fashion. Lord, that we might be able to prevent so many from getting sick. We ask that You'd help the first responders and keep them safe. We pray that You'd watch over our police department and authorities. Lord, during these times that is coming in the weeks that might be trying and taxing as people don't know what's going on, we ask that You'd give them wisdom and discernment. We pray You'd give our government the wisdom it needs to lead during this time. We ask You'd have Your hand upon our president, that You'd keep him safe. But Lord, that more importantly, that You'd give him the wisdom that comes from God. Lord, that You'd give him the wisdom that comes from You, that he might know how to lead a people during this time. When we think of our churches, Lord, we ask You'd protect each church in this country, each church in this world. Lord, that You'd keep them safe, help them to continue to be steadfast and sure, help them to continue to give the gospel. We pray for the pastors of those churches, that You'd have Your hand upon them mightily, that You'd watch over them and keep them safe and give them the wherewithal to continue. Help them to be depression-free. Help them to mitigate the stress. Help them to trust in you more so now than ever before. We ask you to keep our missionaries safe and that you'd meet their needs. We ask that you'd give our evangelists across this world, give them the message that comes from you, to be able to convey to the people. We ask that you'd be with the sick and the infirm, that you'd have your hand upon them and help them. We ask that you'd comfort the elderly. Lord, I pray for those in this church, Lord, that have real decisions to make. And Lord, you know what they are. Lord, we ask that you'd answer. We have people that are looking for an answer. They're looking for the answer that only comes from you. Lord, we ask that you'd give them that answer, that you'd meet their needs, that you'd help them and be an encouragement to them. And Father, we ask that you'd help us tonight as we worship. We ask that you'd help us to sing songs of praise. We ask that you'd help us to remain humble as you bless us and care for us during this time. We ask these things in your Son's precious and holy name, Jesus. Amen. We're going to sing some hymns now. We're using the Majesty's hymnal. And so I invite my son, Logan, to come up and lead the song service at this time.
Thank you.
Amen. Singing is very, very important. Pray for me. We have a few more lessons as we've been going through Sunday evening in the book of Psalms. If you have a Bible this evening, turn into Psalm 37, if you would. Psalm 37. We've been making our way through this first book of the Psalms, and we're fast approaching the end of this first book of Psalms, and gives Pastor an opportunity to pray and see where the Lord would have him to go. We've been taking an Old Testament survey, and when we got to the book of Psalms, we have made a little pit stop here as we've looked at the very first book of the Psalms. The book of Psalms is really divided up into five sections, and we've been taking our time going through each of the Psalms in the first book. And this evening we find ourselves in Psalm 37. In Psalm 37, I've titled this Care of the Righteous. We have here masterful teaching of the Psalms, as it's 10 of 17 that have such a title. And we notice this psalm has a title. It's the Psalm of David. Many suppose this was written when David was in his old age. It's also the third of seven psalms, which are sometimes called the alphabet psalms. It's often considered in conjunction with Psalm 73 and the book of Habakkuk, which deal with the prosperity of the wicked. And there is no need to argue or debate over the authorship of this psalm. As notice, it's got a title. It says a Psalm of David. We ought to be just comfortable in recognizing that since it's a Psalm of David, that he's the one that wrote it, and just leave it at that. Therefore, we can conclude that David wrote this psalm, and most likely he wrote it as a king who was rather old, perhaps maybe in his 60s, as we see in verse 25. Psalm 37, verse 25, I have been young, and now I'm old, yet I have not seen the righteous forsaken, nor his seed begging bread. It's a great verse to meditate on. It's a great verse to memorize. It's a great verse to trust in, especially considering the turmoil and circumstances of the days we live in. God is not going to forsake us. God's not going to leave us behind. God's going to care for us. It's God's responsibility. So we just have to give it to God. Some suppose that this was recorded after the sorrowful events of 2 Samuel 19 regarding Ziba and Mephibosheth. And the German theologian A.W. Hensberg supposes that David took much of this from the book of Proverbs, which is strange considering that Proverbs is written by Solomon. So, again, we'll just take it the fact that it says it's a Psalm of David and that David wrote it. We can trust in that. We can trust that David was a king, and we can also see that he was very prophetic in his nature. I like to think that the Apostle John had this psalm in mind as well. As you read Revelation chapter 14, verse number 12, here is the patience of the saints. Here are they that keep the commandments of God and the faith of Jesus. This psalm has the repeated phrase, fret not. Notice in verse 1, fret not. Notice in verse 7, fret not. Notice in verse number 8, fret not. Really, it's the fret not psalm. We are in position to aid the reader as well as the believer to fret not, right? And we're going to trust in God. We're going to have to trust in God. Our position is to be obedient to the Lord and not be afraid. The word fret is to be vexed or chafed or irritated, something we should never allow to consume us. Fret means worry. It seems to be a southern word. If you went down south, you'd hear people say that. But we ought not to be worried about the day we live in. We ought not to be worried about the circumstances. We ought not to be worried about things that we can't control. We have to learn to give them to God. We have to learn to trust in God. And while we might struggle with worry, we should never fret, as we see the Lord is in control. I think verse 7 is the key verse in this psalm. Verse 7 says, rest in the Lord and wait patiently for him. Fret not thyself because of him who prospereth in his way, because of the man who bringeth wicked devices to pass. I think it's interesting that we, in the midst of this viral outbreak, this pandemic, you have people that are hoarding sanitation device, hand sanitizer, toilet paper, they're hoarding food, those things. But just know that they've passed a law now that is illegal for you to bring back the surplus that you've been hoarding. So those that have been trying to hoard and make a profit, now they're going to try to go back and bring all the extra hand sanitizer. They're not going to be able to sell it. See, we ought not to fret not. We ought not to worry about the wicked as they prosper. God will take care of it. We are told to rest in the Lord, and it would do us well to remember that those that failed to believe the Lord and his promises were never able to enter into the rest, Hebrews 4:1. Because they didn't believe in God. Remember in the wilderness wandering, they sent the spies. They sent the 12 spies, and 10 brought back an evil report, and 2 brought back a good report. And God judged them because the people were willing to believe the evil report. The Bible says they wandered around and they were not able to enter in to God's rest. We desire to be in the rest of God. We desire to be in the place of God. We desire to get the comfort that comes from God. In order to do so, we're going to need to believe in his promises. It's during this rest that we wait. And wait's an interesting word. It means serve, like a waiter or a waitress. It doesn't just mean idly sitting by doing nothing. So we serve the Lord patiently. Thus, we should never let our minds wander or fret about those things that are prospering, those who are wicked. The Lord will eventually reward them in kind. And so this evening, we'll take a look at this psalm and see what the Lord will speak to our hearts. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father, I need your help tonight. Lord, ask that you'd help me. Give me clarity of mind and thought. I pray you'd loosen my tongue. Lord, pray that you'd take this message and use it mightily, that you'd be able to reach so many souls, that you'd be a help and a comfort to all those that tune in. We ask these things in your Son's name, Jesus. Amen. It's interesting that during this time now, is if when you're around people, if someone coughs or sneezes, everybody like panics because, oh, they're so worried. If you're like me, you have sinuses and you have allergies and you have other things that are going on, and sometimes you get a catch in your throat or a frog in your throat and you have to cough, and then suddenly you cough and everybody's panic. Don't worry. All is good. We see here in verse 1, though, Psalm 37, verse 1, fret not thyself because of evildoers, neither be thou envious against the workers of iniquity. We shouldn't be worried about those that are prospering. We shouldn't be worried about those that are evil. They're evildoers. They profit off other people. They do so many things, and we shouldn't be worried about the fact that they haven't come to the light of justice. We shouldn't worry or fret at the fact that they haven't been prosecuted yet. We should just know that one day they will. We ought not to fret because of the evildoers. Mindful of Doeg, evildoer. The Old Testament killed all those priests. He eventually got his. We should understand that fretting is an agitation of the mind marked by complaint or impatience, a disturbance of temper, irritation, as he keeps his mind in a continual fret. Much of the croaking of the media today is designed to get everybody to be fretful and to be worried and to wonder what's going to take place. Yet, we understand that, boy, it's the grace of God, because we trust in God, that we can step upon the foundation of God, the stepping stones, to have the blessed life and the fullness of faith. As we trust in God, we ought not to fret. We ought not to be envious of the foolish. We ought not to desire to see the desire to have the prosperity of the wicked. We just have to continue to keep on serving God. Verse 2, for they shall soon be cut down, like the grass, and wither as a green herb. Meaning that the wicked are short in time. The wicked are not eternal. They're not going to live forever. They're not going to be around forever. They're just rewards one day. Doeg got his one day. King Saul got his one day. Judas got his one day. King Ahab got his one day. It's going to come around. The devil's going to get his one day. So we ought not to fret. We just understand that eventually they're going to get theirs. And so we need to have the sight of the sinner. We need to have the sight of hell. We need to understand that time is short, verse 3, but we need to trust in the Lord. And then notice, not only do we need to trust in the Lord, notice it says, and do good. Many people trust in the Lord. Comes around, but do they do good? As this morning, we're supposed to be hearers of the word and doers of the word. Many people trust in God, yet are they doing good? It's okay to be a do-gooder. It's okay to love your neighbor. It's okay to love your family. It's okay to help your neighbor. It's okay to do good works. It's okay to continue to try to share the love of Christ. We have to trust in the Lord. We have to do good. So shalt thou dwell in the land. And verily thou shalt be fed. Remember, if we liken this to the idea of going into God's rest, and you can see the picture of the nation Israel, looking at the promised land, looking at the land that flows with milk and honey, looking at those pomegranates, looking at those figs, looking at all the fruit that came from the promised land. It's a sign that they should have entered in, and yet we have the Word of God, we have the preaching of the Word of God, we have the answers of prayer that come from us going to the feet of God and getting our supplications answered. When you see all that fruit, we should be willing to be fed in the land. We should understand where we're going. We should understand that this isn't our home. We can't preserve the earth. We can't preserve the structures. We're only here temporarily, and so our desire and our focus needs to be heaven bound. We still have to live right, but we need to feed upon the right things. Verse number 4, delight thyself also in the Lord. So not only do we have to trust him in verse 3, not only do we have to do good, not only are we fed in the land, but we have to delight ourselves in the Lord. We have to be delightful of the things that come from God. We have to understand that there's a certainty that comes from God's supply. Right? The mercies of God are renewed day by day. The Bible is as fresh tomorrow as it was today. But there's a certain supply that God provides to us. Not only is there a certain supply, there's a sufficiency in the supply that God provides for us. As we've seen in verse number 25 of not seeing the righteous forsaken. Boy, there's a sufficiency. And that sufficiency is both for our physical body, it's also for our soul. As I so often say, God's taking care of me. I haven't missed a meal. Have you missed a meal? No, I don't think we've missed a meal. God's taking care of us. God meets our needs. God feeds us. He feeds us in truth, right? There's a certain provision that comes from the spiritual food that you can eat, from the manna that comes from heaven. Go back and read Exodus chapter 16 and learn that the manna falls every morning. And you can go out and gather as much as you want. And you can eat as much as you want. The only person that limits you from eating the manna that comes from heaven is yourself. And your unwillingness to open the scriptures and open the book and spend time in it. We also need to understand that there's a duty that we have in choosing the provision. Just like the nation Israel in the wilderness, it's our duty to make our attempts to go and spend time with God and feed upon the truth of the Word of God. It's our duty. We have to choose to do so. We have to choose to trust in God. We have to choose to do those things. And we have to delight ourselves in those things. Right? He's going to give us the desires of our heart. Isaiah chapter 58, verse 14, the Bible says, "Then shalt thou delight thyself in the Lord, and I will cause thee to ride upon the high places of the earth and feed thee with the heritage of Jacob thy father, for the mouth of the Lord hath spoken it." He's going to restore all things one day. But he's going to give the desires of our hearts. We just have to take time to delight in God and understand that there's a desire that we have as we serve God, is to hear from God, is to have God meet all of our needs. Don't you like it when God answers prayer? Don't you like it when God gives you an opportunity? Don't you like it when God opens a door that only he can open? Don't you like it when God sends the blessings? I think that we do. I think that we like all those things. And so we not only need to trust him, but we need to delight in the Lord. And we cannot delight in him unless we believe that he's the chief and perfect good. He's the creator. He's the almighty. Unless we recognize him as that, we're not going to delight in him. Not only do we need to delight in him, but look at verse 5. It says, commit. Commit thy way unto the Lord. So we have to trust him. We need to do good. We need to feed upon his word. We need to delight ourselves in the Lord. And then we need to commit ourselves. That's where the rub meets the... That's where the rub comes in. People don't like to commit. We live in a society where it's non-committal. I don't know if I can really commit to that. I don't really know if I can be there. I don't really know if I can do that. No one wants to commit. Here he's saying we need to commit. We need to commit to God. There's perfect trust and delight that comes when we commit to God. Right? He's committed to us. He's committed to meeting your needs. He's committed to providing eternal life. He's committed to bringing the sacrifice that was enough to pay for the sins of all the world. He's committed. And if he's committed, how much more do you suppose that we should be committed? I think that we should be committed. But we live in this non-committal world. And, well, I don't really know. And I don't know. And that's the world we live in. And yet we need to get back to a time and a place where, man, we're committed. Just imagine if your employer was as committed to you as you are to them. Just imagine if the government was as committed. Just imagine if your relationship were dependent upon how well you're committed to the other person. And you're going to say, Pastor, that's the world we live in. Exactly. Exactly. And yet here we are, we're supposed to commit thy way unto the Lord. We're supposed to trust in him. We're supposed to have perfect commitment to him. We're supposed to give ourselves to him, our ways to him, our purpose to him, and then let him mold us and shape us and direct us as we've committed ourselves to him. Nothing wrong with committing yourself to Christ. Nothing wrong with giving Jesus Christ your life. He'll take it. He'll do something with it. He'll make you what he wants you to be. A life that's wholly committed to God should be free. Should be free of fretting. Should be free of those things. We see in Matthew chapter 6, I'm sorry. Matthew chapter 6, verse 25. Notice what we find. Matthew 6, 25. Bible says, therefore I say unto you, take no thought for your life, what you shall eat, or what you shall drink, nor yet for your body, and what you shall put on. Is not life more than meat, and the body more than raiment? Verse 26, behold the fowls of the air, for they sow not, neither do they reap, nor gather into barns, and yet your heavenly Father feedeth them. Are you not much better than they? Are we not much better than animals out there? I think that we are. Right? He sent his son to die for us. He didn't send his son to die for the animals. He sent his son to die for sinners. So we're much more valuable. And if he cares for the birds, and he cares for the squirrels, and he cares for those things, how much more are you supposed that we are? Verse 27, which of you, by taking thought, can add one cubit unto his stature? Meaning, have you ever thought that you could maybe, I just tell yourself, self-will, well, I need 4 more inches. I want to be 6 feet. Can I just get 4 more inches so I'm 6 feet? It doesn't work. We can't make more hair sprout. That's why the snake oil men run around and sell to try to get your hair to grow. It doesn't work. We can't do that. We can't add that. Verse 28, and why take ye thought for raiment? Consider the lilies of the field, how they grow. They toil not, neither do they spin. And yet I say unto you that even Solomon in all his glory was not arrayed like one of these. Wherefore, if God so clothe the grass of the field, which today is, and tomorrow is cast into the oven, shall he not much more clothe you, O ye of little faith? See, we're supposed to commit ourselves to God and then let God solve the problems. Give God the fretting. Give God the things that you're worried about. That fretting, that desire that we have internally to worry, be anxious about things, it consumes us. It ruins your stomach. It causes you to chew all your fingernails off. It causes you to pull your hair out and your hair turn gray as you worry about things that you can't control. And if we just commit ourselves and commit our way to God and give it to God, watch and see what happens. You won't have the upset stomach. You won't be on the jitters because you're worried about things as you're trusting in God. We have to learn to commit to God and understand that when we commit to God, that we should be encouraged, that when we cast all of our cares upon him, He cares for us, 1 Peter 5. We're supposed to cast them upon him and give them to him. We come to the Lord and we cast our cares at his feet, and then we get up and we take him back and we carry him back away with us. And then wonder why he hasn't answered. That's because we didn't really fully give him to God. Boy, we have to commit thy way unto the Lord. Trust also in him, and he shall bring it to pass. He's the one that's in control. He's the one that's going to dictate things. Verse 6, and he shall bring forth, Psalm 37, verse 6, and he shall bring forth thy righteousness as the light, and thy judgment as the noonday. We should understand that our trust is in God, our commitment's in God. And as we've committed ourselves to God, we should understand that we should have constructed a hearty resignation towards God as we desire to see the things of God. And so not only have we constructed it, but we need to continue by faith, continue trusting in God, continue committing to God. Just continue by faith. We have to start exercising faith. Certain times that we live in, I believe God is really going to try our faith. And like I said this morning, how fitting that we're going through the book of James. We're supposed to count it all joy. Right? We have to continue by faith. And as we continue by faith, boy, watch the things that God does as they unfold by the Lord. And we understand His ultimate goal, His ultimate desire is to bring forth righteousness as light. Right? Righteousness shouldn't be hidden. The righteous people shouldn't be cowering. The righteous people should be bold. They should be brave. They should be secure in what they believe. And then watch and see what God does. And there's comfort that comes from not only the Scripture, but there's comfort that comes from being righteous. And understand that the judgment's as noonday. I'm telling you, the judgments are coming. They're coming. All you got to do is read the book of Revelation. Verse 7. And not only are we supposed to trust Him, not only are we supposed to delight. You notice how the Lord lays this all out? Notice how he's laid it all out. David, in his infinite wisdom, notice he's laying out a perfect outline that you can follow. Verse by verse. Right? Verse 3, trust. Verse 4, delight. Verse 5, commit. Verse 7, rest. Rest in the Lord. Rest in the Lord and wait patiently for him. Fret not thyself, because of him who prospereth in his way, because of the man who bringeth wicked devices to pass. Notice how he's got it all laid out, and now we're coming to the rest. And you're going to rest in something, but we should rest in the Lord. And as we rest in the Lord, we should rest in the will of God. Revelation chapter 12, verse 1 and 2. We'll find the will of God. What is that? Good and acceptable and perfect will of God. Find the will of God. Rest secure in the will of God. So I mentioned on the radio earlier today, in Acts 27, Paul, in the midst of Euryclodon, was resting in what? In the perfect will of God. He was right where God wanted him. Though everything else was going wrong, Paul was resting in the will of God. And we need to rest in the will of God, for whatever He wills is for our good. It's for our good. That's James 1. That's that diverse temptation. That's that trial that He sends for the betterment of each of us. This virus that's running rampant across the world, ultimately it's going to be for the betterment of everybody that looks at it and takes it and uses what comes about for your betterment, as God is refining all of us for His purpose. We have to learn to rest in the will of God. Not only have to rest in the will of God, but we ought to rest in the love of God. Can you rest in the love of God? Now, John 3:16, for God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in Him should not perish, but have everlasting life. 1 John chapter 4, verse number 8 talks about perfect love. Boy, we ought to rest in that love. We ought to meditate upon the Word of God. We ought to meditate upon Christ's words. And He say, He first loved us. Right? We love Him because He first loves us. We need to learn to rest in the mercy of God. The mercies of God. They're renewed day by day. Aren't you glad they're renewed day by day? Because today, guess what? We fall short. Tomorrow's a brand new day. We've got new mercy that's supplied to us to help us to fill our needs. There's a rest that comes in the mercy of God. There's a rest that comes in the Word of God. This is going to be more and more important every day. And as you get older, you young children that are listening, as you get older, this book is going to become more and more cherishable every day. I'm mindful of a pastor friend of mine that when his dad passed away, he took the opportunity to send his dad's Bible out to get it rebound. And I'm telling you, he cherishes that book that his dad had. He's a pastor now. But he cherishes all the little notes in the margin of his Bible, all the little verses that are highlighted. But he also cherishes the fact that God was communicating to his dad. He also cherishes the fact that he's able to get in the Word of God and God is able to communicate to him. I'm just telling you, it's going to become more and more and more important in the days we live. And as you get older, the Word of God is going to become more and more important. An old mentor of mine, he's with the Lord now. And I remember when his eyesight was failing. His eyesight was failing. He couldn't read the Bible anymore. He got his wife to read him the Bible. And they said, it's not the same, but it's close. I mean, he eventually was legally blind and couldn't read the Bible. He got one of the biggest TVs I'd seen at the time, you know, some 50 or 60 inch television. And he said he could sit 2 feet from the television and still only make out the shapes. Word of God became more and more precious to him. And as we get older, from finding the Word of God and spending time in the Word of God, there's a rest that we get in relationship to God. Right? Doesn't He fulfill our needs? Doesn't He fill us? Doesn't He satisfy us? Shouldn't we rest in Him? In that Matthew chapter 11, take upon me my yoke? And shouldn't we endeavor to spend time with God as we find rest in God? He says here, rest in the Lord. We're going to rest in something. Notice it doesn't say rest in your couch or rest in your recliner or rest in sports or rest in politics. It says rest in the Lord. Obviously, the rest in the Lord for us as New Testament believers is manifest in the person of the Lord Jesus Christ. Rest. We need to rest in Him and we need to wait patiently for Him. Meaning that we obviously need to wait for Him to act and wait for Him to move. But while we're waiting for Him to do something, we need to continue to serve Him and do the tasks that He's given to us. There's a stillness that comes from resting in God. There's a stillness that comes from waiting patiently. He says, fret not thyself because of him who prosper. We don't need to worry about what's going on in the wicked world as they make more money and they become more famous and more wicked and there's more debauchery that runs rampant. God is in control. We ought not to run in front of God. We ought not to try to beat God to giving us the blessing. We just need to wait patiently for Him and serve Him. And because the wicked man bringeth those devices to pass, He'll get the wicked in the end. We have to have a stillness in God. And understand, just like Paul in Acts 7, just ride that storm out because we're right where God wants us to be. And though one day we'll cut those anchors all loose and that ship might be destroyed, but we'll land on that shore. Our body might fail, our body might fall apart, but we'll be on that shore and we'll be in that perfect rest. There's perfect rest that comes from serving God. We can do things in the flesh and we get tired and we get worn out. But when we serve God in the Spirit, boy, there's a rest that comes because God is fueling us and God is feeding us to do His work and do His good pleasure. Now notice as we follow this outline out, we get to verse 8, it continues. That's why many people preach the first 8 verses. It says, cease. I'm just showing you, you can study the Bible yourself. You can see verse 1 starts out fret, verse 2 starts out trust, verse 4 starts out delight, 5 commit, 7 rest. Now verse number 8, cease. He says, cease from anger. We ought to cease from anger. We ought not to be angry. I mean, no one wants the school shut down. No one wants the job shut down. No one wants the economy going the way it is. No one wants the stock market going the way it is. Nobody wants the rest homes closed up. Nobody wants those things, but we got not to be angry about it. We can't control it. We can't do those things. He says, cease from anger and forsake wrath. Boy, we need to make sure that we understand our anger, understand our nature. Sinful to be angry, sinful to do those things. He wants us to cease. He says, fret not thyself in any wise to do evil. Boy, we got to be careful. We need to cease from present anger. We can get mad at, be mad at the virus that slipped out, be mad at then be mad at someone who was genetically engineering the virus. And then why were they genetically engineering the virus? Maybe they were looking for a cure in some other sickness. We can't be angry. We need to make sure that we're ceased from those things. Not be wrathful. It's madness to go down that road. We need to watch our temper. We need to be disciplined. It's okay to be passionate, but there's a line between passion and wrath. There's a line between those things. We need to make sure that we walk that line and understand those things. And we need to fret not thyself in any wise to do evil. If you got a Bible, turn to Romans chapter 3. Romans chapter 3. We find some similar thoughts that the Apostle Paul was inspired to pen for us here in this book. Verse number 5, Romans 3, verse 5. But if our unrighteousness command the righteousness of God, what shall we say? Is God unrighteous who taketh vengeance? I speaketh as a man, God forbid. Then how shall God judge the world? For if the truth of God hath more abound through my lie unto his glory, why yet am I also judged as a sinner? Meaning they were slandering Paul. Verse 8 tells you that. And not rather, as we be slanderously reported, and some affirm that we say, let us do evil, that good may come, whose damnation is just. Just know that it's never right. It's never right to do evil that you think good might come. It's never right to break the word of God. Never right to lie, to try to shield somebody. It's never right. And that's what he says back here in the Psalms. We ought not to fret not thyself because... He says, fret not thyself in any wise to do evil. We shouldn't be desiring to do something that we know is not right, hoping that something good will come from it. I'm telling you, nothing good will come from behaving that way. We need to avoid all kinds of this idea of fretfulness and this impatience and this weariness and this chafing. We ought not to fret about our actions. If we just trust in God, if we've committed ourselves to God, if we trusted in God, if our rest is in God, we've committed ourselves, we should cease from anger. We shouldn't be fretting. We shouldn't be thinking about doing something that may or may not be right. If it's not in line with the Word of God, just know that it's wrong. It's not rocket science. If it doesn't align with what God says in His Word, it's wrong. Verse number 9, for evildoers shall be cut off, but those that wait upon the Lord, they shall inherit the earth. Boy, there's blessings that come, understanding that the evildoers are going to get their way. But we should trust and understand in God, and we should understand that we should be humble. We should understand that it's the humble that receive the blessings that come from God. And the nation Israel is going to get all the land one day. They don't have the whole promised land. They only have a small portion. All that bickering over there is about fulfilling what God said and what God decreed to give them, the royal land grant. They still don't have it. But one day they're going to get it. And for me and you, boy, we need to wait upon the Lord. Verse 10, for yet a little while, and the wicked shall not be. Yea, thou shalt diligently consider his plea, and it shall not be. All right, diligently. Understand and consider the things. Consider what happens when people depart from God. Consider and understand where they're going and where they've left to. And consider whether if we follow their path, are we going to be in the same lot? Many people leave church and they claim their life's going to be so much better. And yet, as time goes on and you look at their life, it hasn't gotten any better. It's gotten worse. And just know that to be true. Verse 11, but the meek shall inherit the earth and shall delight themselves in the abundance of peace. Boy, that should be a terror to the wicked. That should be a terror to the wicked and comfort to us. We should find comfort in the fact that one day God is going to restore the earth. One day God's going to bring down a new heaven and new earth. We should find complete comfort in the fact that the wicked is going to be gone. Got a little note in my Bible here. It says 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 11, which says, therefore, the terror of the Lord, we persuade men, but we are made manifest unto God, and I trust also are made manifest in your conscience. In other words, our conscience, because we know the terror of the Lord, and we know what's going to happen to the evildoers, to the wicked, that's the unsaved, that's the people that never trust in Christ. We should know where they're going, and we should be persuaded to tell them and help them so that they can see. Because you can follow this, they can follow this, and learn to not fret, to trust in God. Terror. Terror's real. So I gave on Wednesday, God doesn't want us to be in terror. He doesn't want the believer to be in terror. He doesn't want the world to be wondering what's going to go on and be scared. He's got perfect comfort. The problem is no one seeks after God. We got to learn to seek after God and seek the things of God. And then know that we can help those and minister to those. Verse 12, the wicked plotteth against the just and gnash upon him with his teeth. And you don't need me to tell you what. You know what that means. The wicked plotteth against the just. Man gnasheth upon him with his teeth. Always biting. Always gnawing. Always having something critical to say. Always chewing. Always just going. Good reference for you is Proverbs 1:26. Goes with that verse. And verse 13. The Lord shall laugh at him. For he seeth his day coming. Boy, he's laughing. The Lord is. Lord's laughing because he sees the day coming. Understanding the time and the circumstances. Understanding what's going to take place. Understanding where we are in time. Understanding what's coming down the road. Understanding that it's getting closer and closer and closer to the church being taken out and in full calamity running rampant on the earth. As you read the book of Revelation and the seals are open and the riders of the four horsemen of the apocalypse, as everybody says, as they start riding and you watch death and hell and destruction and you start watching the judgment start coming down as everything's raining down from heaven as God starts judging the earth. He says he's laughing. The Lord shall laugh at him, for he seeth his day coming. He knows it's coming. He knows what's coming to them, and he's still willing to save them, but they're so hard-hearted that they keep refusing his efforts. They keep denying his word. They keep denying the message. They keep stonewalling him. He's laughing. Verse 14, the wicked have drawn out their sword, and they have bent their bow to cast down the poor and the needy, and to slay such as be of upright conversation. Man, that day's coming. That's the wickedness that we find in the tribulation. That's the self-destruction of man devouring neighbor, stealing all the things. I'm thankful that we haven't got that way. I'm thankful that people are still at least peaceable. People are still willing to at least coexist yet and continue. But our prayers ought to be that, boy, the Lord protect our nation. He protect our communities as this lingers. As people start to become more and more uptight and tense about the circumstances, that means that we're going to have to do all that we can via social media, via the mailman, the postman, however, to convey the love of Christ to the neighbors and coworkers and friends and family so that they remain calm. And we have a perfect peace. We understand where we're going. They have no idea. And one day they'll rise up to start lashing out. Verse 15, their sword shall enter into their heart, their own heart, and their bow shall be broken. Verse 16, and a little that a righteous man hath is better than the riches of many wicked. Is that not truthful? Isn't it better to have a little than to have a lot? You talk to those people in a desire to have all the money, all the finances. Go talk to a famous person. Go talk to a really rich person. They'll have everything that money can buy, and they're still not happy. And then go talk to the little farmer out in the country somewhere that's got a couple acres and a little tractor and a little mule and a little couple of chickens, and they're as happy as can be, though they don't have, you know, the thousands of acres. They're happy. A little that a righteous man hath is better. Better. But God gives us all those things. God is able to provide and care for us. It's up to me and to you to understand the self-destructive nature of evil, the self-destruction that comes from fretting, the self-destruction that comes from desiring the things that God hasn't given you, He hasn't given me, but He's given us a heritage, He's given us righteousness, He's given us real gold and silver, He's given us something better than money can buy. All the scripture verses you memorize, boy, you better start memorizing more scriptures. You're going to need them as the days go. As the days get long and as the Lord tarries and as the world gets wicked and wicked and wicked. Just telling you. Mindful of that verse there about Noah. I am. Go back and read Noah's narrative. The Bible says he was a preacher of righteousness. He got a small family. He didn't have much. He built a giant ark. And yet I'm sure the world around him was full of wickedness, full of evil, full of evildoers that were prospering. And yet he was happy. The Bible says that when the Lord comes back, it'll be as the days of Noah. And go back and think of what was like when Noah was building the ark. And we know there was wicked, only evil continually. We know that, Genesis 6. But people didn't have any time for God. That's what it comes down to. It's not about their sins. Sin's always been rampant in the day. We know that because Noah was perfect. His genes were perfect. That's why his children got on the ark. But yet they didn't have any time for God. Mindful during 9/11 that, boy, people started packing the churches because they were afraid. This is something real. We're going to have to get back to God. And now we're 19 years from that, and we have something else going on, and you know what we're not seeing? We're not seeing people looking for God. See, people don't have any time for God. And interesting, and right with God's character, He strips away all those things that we use to separate us from God. Hollywood, sports, politics, education, work, all stripped away. All gone. Now it's just, really, it's just Him. Are we going to seek God? That's how you know we're going down the road that we're going. Because people don't have any time for God. Because people won't trust in God. Because people won't delight in God. Because people won't commit to God. They won't cease from anger. They won't cease from their own understanding. The little that a righteous man hath is better than the riches of many wicked. Verse 17. For the arms of the wicked shall be broken, but the Lord upholdeth the righteous. See, that's another one of those verses that tells you exactly where we are. David was so prophetic. We don't like to think of David as a prophet, but David was so prophetic. He's writing about the Antichrist. He's writing about, obviously, what you find in Zechariah chapter 11, verse 17. Gives you a picture of the Antichrist with the withered arm. Also in Ezekiel chapter 30, verse 21, about Pharaoh and about how God broke Pharaoh's arm. He'd given it all in context here. Notice how relevant this is to the day we live in. Notice how God keeps driving this point that, boy, He's going to get the wicked. Verse 18, the Lord knoweth the days of the upright. He knows our days. He knows your days. He knows my days. He knows the days that the church has left on this earth. He knows the days that are going to come from behind of famine. He knows the days of judgment and pestilence and plagues and all those things that are coming behind. But he knows our days. The Lord knoweth the day of the upright, and their inheritance shall be forever. We have a home in heaven. He knows what our days are. Later in the Psalms, Moses says, Lord, teach us to number our days. Kind of goes right with our vision this year. We're right at the apex, right? This is the year 2020. Everybody wants 2020 vision. I said before, jokingly, our vision ought to be 2020 hindsight, right? We ought to be able to look back and see, but we chose for what is your life? What is your life? God knows what our days are. God knows what they are. And he's provided inheritance. And so we need to go forward, though we don't understand what's going on, though we don't have to know all the details, but we can have confidence and trust in God that he's going to care for us, that he's going to provide for us, that he's going to preserve us, that he's going to help us, that he's going to keep our church going. We can trust in God. We can look to God. But he knows the days. So the question is, not only does he know the days, the question to you and to me is, what are we going to do with those days? That's the real question. They're a vapor. Appears for a little time. As I said this morning, before long, it's going to be Christmas. Really, before long, it's going to be Christmas. We're already almost to April. We're already almost a third of the way through 2020. 2019 was bizarre. 2020 is going to be bizarre, worse. Bizarre-er, I don't know if that's the correct word, but it's going to be something like that. The Lord knows our days. We need to make sure that we use all the time that God has given us. Because if we see verse 19, they shall not be ashamed in evil time. I think this is evil time. Don't you think it's evil time? I think we can go back and look through human history and I can show you evil time after evil time after evil time. We're in evil time, and notice it says that they shall not be ashamed in the evil time. And in the days of famine, they shall be satisfied. I'm just telling you, if this lingers on, if this is protracted for a continual, uncertain, determinate number of days and weeks and months, the churches are going to struggle, and we're going to start slowly or rapidly turning into the Amos, where Amos said that, boy, there's going to be a famine in the land, and the famine's not going to be for bread. It's going to be for the Word of God. And what you need and what I need and what everybody needs, they need to be by the very words of God during a pandemic, during an epidemic, during a viral outbreak that you have no idea was coming, but you need the Word of God because the peace of God that passes all understanding is right here as God comforts you. And he said, I will never leave thee nor forsake thee, according to Hebrews chapter 13, verse number 5. We ought not to be ashamed. We're going to be satisfied. But notice, as we close, if I started out talking about in the wilderness how they were seeking the manna, and manna was falling, the nation Israel had to seek and gather the manna. And we're not to be ashamed, and we're in an evil time, and I believe that we are. He says, we in a famine, we'll be satisfied. You and myself, we're going to have to seek the Word of God. We're going to have to seek the bread of heaven. That means that we're going to have to dust off our Bible. We're going to have to go back and start opening the pages and spending time in here, because the true wisdom that we all need, that our government needs, that our businesses need, that our schools need, that our children need, is right here in the very pages of Scripture. And if we as a nation, if we as a church, if we as believers don't get back to the Word of God, we will be ashamed. And you want to know what will happen? We will suffer famine, and we will be malnourished, and we will not have sufficient strength in the day of adversity, because we haven't been feeding upon the Word of God. Just know that none of this came about. This did not sneak God by surprise, but we are here for such a time as this. Hope that you'll spend extra time this week in prayer. Hope you'll spend extra time this week in the Word of God. Hope you'll spend extra time praying and evangelizing. Hope you'll start really thinking about how can I get the message of God out to those that are needing it. Because I'm telling you, they all need it out there. They're not panicking today. Maybe they won't be fearful next week. But I'm just telling you, in the weeks to come, they're going to be starting to be more and more and more concerned. And they're going to start fretting. And it's going to be your job and my job to convince them to not to fret, but to trust in God, to delight in God, to commit their way to God, to rest in the Lord, to cease from anger, and start feeding upon the Word of God and asking God to supply all their needs. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Heavenly Father, we are dependent upon You. We ask that You'd help us. Help us as a nation of believers, Lord, that we'd be able to be steadfast and secure as we would take what You've given to us. Lord, that You'd help us, that You'd empower us, that You'd equip us to have the desire to not fret, that we might delight and trust in You, that we might seek after the things that You've provided for us. And Lord, help us to be, boy, to be that lightning rod of faith, that we could be able to show others our faith in You, and it would be contagious, and they wouldn't be catching the coronavirus. They'd be catching faith that comes from God to trust in Your Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. Help them to seek the Word of God. Help them to seek You. Help them to really find the true mercies of God. Lord, we need Your help. We ask that You'd equip us and empower us for the Word. We ask these things in Your Son's precious name, Jesus, amen. So glad that you decided to come out this evening and hope that you were blessed. This is Pastor Daniel Meyer thanking you for tuning in. We'll see you Wednesday night, 7 p.m. Doors will be open if you'd like to come, although we restrict attendance to 10 people. But we'll be on Facebook Live. We'll be uploading the sermons to the church's YouTube channel. We'll see you soon. God bless. Pastor Meyer.